All right. So welcome back. This afternoon, we're going to hear from three very different perspectives. And these three different perspectives, I think, are really important because they intersect in the core of what the Lunar Surface Innovation Consortium needs to be useful to NASA, to be useful to the nation, to be useful to all of you as well. We have first Tori Bruno from ULA here to talk about the cislunar economy. And I met Tori 5 or 6 years ago. And I got to tell you, I at that time was running an XPRIZE team at Penn State. And I was enamored of the amazing things that were being done at Blue Origin and SpaceX. And my students were going off to work at places like Virgin Galactic, as well as Northrop Grumman and Lockheed Martin. And I thought that was where all the excitement was. And then I saw Tori speak at an event that the Atlantic Magazine held in Atlanta, where we were on a panel together. And I was reminded of the fact that in order to do anything successful in this industry, you have got to be pushing the limits and visionary in terms of what we do. And I'm really, really pleased that he's here to talk again, not just because of what I saw then, but because also of your role on the National Space Council's User Advisory Group. One of the things that the UAG and the National Space Council has been discussing is mentoring in this industry to bring in new actors, new contributors to space as we grow more and more beyond just what we've done over the last few decades. So without further ado, please help me welcome Tori Bruno to the stage. Okay. So thank you. Do you have to give the turn?
She's got it.
She's got it. Okay.
Wherever she is. There you are. Well, good afternoon. And thank you for your time and attention. So I am going to talk a little bit today about how our country's current ambitions to go back to the moon, to have a sustained presence, to have this Artemis program are going to open the door to a multi-trillion dollar cislunar space economy and pave the way back to Mars. So I'm going to tell you some things you already know, but I'm going to put them in that context. And where is George Sowers? George, raise your hand. Where are you? George Sowers is back over there. So if what I say is brilliant, it's all me. But if you don't believe a word of it, that's the guy right there, George. All right, hit the next slide, please. All right, now it is a legal requirement that whenever a launch service guy comes to a meeting like this, there has to be a rocket video. So bear with us for a moment. Oh, I think that was a Parker Solar Probe rocket went by there real quick.
You have permission to launch.
We have liftoff of the United Launch Alliance.
Liftoff of the United Launch Alliance Delta IV rocket.
All right, I think you get the idea. Let's go ahead and go to the charts. We build a lot of rockets. All right, so before we start, I just wanted to put this return to the moon maybe in a little bit of perspective. So what we've done is put every lunar mission ever onto this one slide. And so the stuff that's on the bottom on the surface of the moon, those are missions that touch the moon. And the ones that are on the top are missions that orbited the moon. And of course, as you can see, back in the 60s, there was a tremendous amount of interest in the moon. And then Apollo ended, and it was a decade and a half before we cared at all. And then finally, we returned in a modest way to lunar orbit. Go to the next slide. 3 decades later, we managed to get out there and actually touch the moon. And by touch, I mean that ULA smashed a Centaur upper stage at extreme velocity into the surface of the moon, which is really cool. And as you guys, some of you may know, threw up ejecta that allowed us to confirm the presence of water on the moon. But 3 decades before we even went back with an unmanned, uncrewed rather probe, so to speak. Next slide. And when we put people back on the moon in 2024, it is going to have been over half a century since people have stood there prior. And I think it's about damn time. What do you guys think? All right, so that's the context. Go to the next slide, please. Now, I thought even though most of you are familiar with Artemis, I might just roll through it very quickly because, you know, nothing against my friends, but just between you and me, NASA has a way of making this look like rocket science. And so I'm going to simplify that for you a little bit. This is how it's going to work when it's all running. There's going to be a space station, not unlike the ISS, out there sitting at the Earth Moon Lagrange Point 2, nice, stable, low energy to maintain orbit. And it's going to be orbiting there, and then SLS will lift this big old Orion capsule with half a dozen or so astronauts. They will go on out, they will dock, they will hop out, and some of them are going to stay there and do deep space research in this gateway space station. Now, a lot of you think it's the lunar gateway, but I'm going to argue that that's really the Mars gateway space station. Now, a little bit later, I'll tell you why, because it really is the pathway to get us safely and routinely out to Mars. And then the others are going to go down to the surface. And the way they're going to do that is they're going to hop in that vehicle that you see there. And then there's a transfer vehicle that will bring them down to low lunar orbit, let them go and go back. It's reusable. And then they will coast around in low lunar orbit till they're lined up with their selected landing point for that mission, descend to the surface, hop out, run around for several days doing research and, you know, astronaut things, climb back in. The ascender will take them back all the way to the space station, leaving the descender down on the surface, and rinse and repeat. So that's how it'll work, not that complicated. Now, how does that all get into place? Go to the next slide. Well, SLS will take the heaviest pieces of gateway up there, obviously, and then probably most of the commercial providers in the sort of space launch vehicle class that exists today will bring up all the smaller pieces and then do the logistics work of keeping this thing going. There's food to be brought up there, there's propellant, there's things to be refueled, there's instruments and all of that. So that's an ongoing operation. Obviously, ULA will be a part of that, as will others. Go to the next slide. So let's see how the missions play out. So the first thing is we're going to send robotic landers to the surface of the moon before we send people. And that's what that sort of lower bunch of arcs are. There's one in the middle that I think is the most interesting. That is the, where's Astrobotic? Are you guys here? Where's Astrobotic? All right, so we're going to take Astrobotic's Peregrine lander to the surface of the moon on the very first inaugural flight of our brand new Vulcan rocket next year, early next year in 2021. And then maybe just as interesting is way down in the left-hand corner, because I'll come back to that later, will be exploration missions to the poles to investigate ice and things like the potential for ISRU of that ice. Potentially, maybe even something like a strategic reserve of fuel on the moon, but I'll come back to that later. So those missions are happening. Meanwhile, on the top arc, there's an Artemis 1 that flies out, loops around the moon, uncrewed, and flies back. End-to-end test. Life support work, propulsion work, nav work. Good. Then Artemis 2 will go out, do the same thing with people. Meanwhile, we'll be building up this gateway space station, until finally it's done and Artemis 3 takes people, docks with the space station, people go down. And that begins this permanent sustained presence. So that's the mission. It's not that complicated. Go to the next slide, please. Now I want to talk a little bit about something you all know. You all know the numbers, but we have a hard time as human beings grasping the unimaginable vastness of space. So I just want to take a slides and try and get that in a way that we can sort of appreciate it, because space is unimaginably big. And even going to the moon involves tremendous distances to be traversed. These are, the slides I'm going to show you are scale drawings now. We don't do that very often. So there is Earth to scale. It's around 9,000 nautical miles in diameter. And there's one of our most popular destinations, LEO. Most popularly about 1,000 miles up from the surface of the Earth. And then the other very popular place we like to go is GEO, and you guys know why. That's where you put a satellite that appears to be fixed in the sky. Only about 22 times further out, 22,000 miles. So we understand that. We do this all the time. Go to the next slide. Okay, here's the moon. Can't find LEO anymore on this scale. Now we're talking about 230,000 miles out, so a factor of 10 to get out there. And then the other place we really want to go in this discussion, one more build, please. Let's get out to Mars. Whoa, 250 million miles. At our sort of average, or really on the closer side of our closest approaches, where it's practical to travel, can't even see geo at this distance. That is a tremendous, unimaginable, vast distance to traverse. And it matters how big this is when we talk about sending people there because of the time it takes to get there. And so I haven't shown it to you out of scale. I haven't shown it to you on a log plot. I've shown it to you how it actually works. But now it turns out that while distance matters for the time it takes to go there, it doesn't really matter in the cost to go there. As you guys know, it's really all about the energy to go there. So I'm going to change the scale to delta V, kilometers per second. Let's go to that one. And the entire thing collapses. This is still to scale. And so all of a sudden, the moon is just right on top of Leo, which is right there in the middle of the page. 9.5 kilometers per second on average to get to Leo. Not very much further than that to get all the way to the lunar surface. And just a little bit more than that again to get all the way out to the surface of Mars. And there we are. They really are all close together in terms of energy. And the moon kind of in a way sort of is on the way to Mars. And so if only we had a way to practically travel around between the moon and near-Earth objects and Mars, you know, if only there were, say, like energy out there that we could use, you know, propellant is what energy is for us in the launch business, and if only there were propellant out there in space, it would be practical to have a routine transportation system between all those interesting bodies where there is all kinds of interesting science to be done. But there's something else we can do out there. I mean, I love science, but there's one thing I love almost as much as science. Anybody know what it might be? Somebody said money. Kinda. Money. Oh, I heard Robbie over here, Robbie Sabatier, say, what Tori loves almost as much as science is a multi-trillion dollar sustainable cislunar economic zone. You all heard her say that, right? Absolutely. All right, so why would we want to go there? That's why. Go to the next slide. So you guys kind of know this, but on the moon and on the near-Earth objects within reach of the moon are tremendous natural resources. Natural resources in such abundance that it defies human imagination. When we rack it all up, our best understanding is there's about 1,000 years worth of Earth's entire planetary production of industrial metals. Iron, titanium, nickel, manganese, all of that stuff, right there, just right there within a few delta Vs of where we are starting from on the moon or in Leo or anywhere nearby. And in terms of precious metals, golly, there's more sitting out there than has been extracted in 20,000 years of human history. More than that. Tremendous wealth. This is the opportunity not just for a trillion-dollar economy, but really, if you think about it, for the beginning of a post-scarcity human future. We are not talking about a future that we stare into for our children and grandchildren that is ever diminishing, where resources are ever more scarce, where they must seek and strive to live ever smaller lives, but a future where abundance is almost beyond our ability to comprehend. That's what's laying right there on our doorstep, a scant few days from this very room where we're sitting right now. If only there was propellant laying around out in the cislunar region for us to go out there and take advantage of and not have to lift up from the gravity well of Earth. Go to the next slide. Oh my gosh. There's 20 billion metric tons of water sitting on the moon. And as any chemistry student knows, because we've all done this experiment in school, it's a rather trivial matter when we did the electrolysis experiment to turn that into oxygen and hydrogen. The most energetic, practical chemical rocket propellants commonly in use today, just right there. And a tremendous quantity of it. Now, when I show this and talk about this to people, sometimes someone will say, Tori, I think you're saying that water is the crude oil of cislunar space. I say, yes, I am. And then sometimes it will say, well, gosh, aren't we just going to use all that up and run out of, you know, just like we are here on Earth with those fossil fuels? Well, probably not. So at today's demand, if we could source our propellant in space instead of from the surface of the Earth, we'd use about 200 tons a year. Well, that's about 100 million years. But in fairness, I'm talking about this giant, you know, $10, $12, $15 trillion a year economy that this eventually grows to. So we're probably going to use some more. So let's say we use, you know, 100 times that demand. Well, that's good for about a million years. So I think we're okay. All right, go to the next slide. Well, it turns out it's not just about the natural resources that we can develop in space. It's also about things we can do in space we cannot practically do here on Earth. These are some examples of things that you can manufacture in microgravity that we can't practically do here. You know, high purity fiber optics, for example, very complex and delicate tissue additively manufactured or grown in space that we just can't do here because of the density effects here on Earth that we can do in space. And so, you know, God forbid any of you ever need a kidney or a heart, an artificial heart, for example. Well, how about a real one that we grew from your actual tissue? What would that be worth to you? This is a bright future we're looking at if we can only tap these resources. Go to the next slide, please. And eventually, when all of this infrastructure is in place, that is going to be kickstarted by the Artemis program, our first permanent research program, and not just scientific research, but industrial research. NASA grasps that, embraces it, as does the Space Council, and we are routinely building large structures in space from materials that we source there. We can have near ubiquitous, low-cost energy anywhere on the surface of the Earth, where solar generation can be done, where it is never cloudy, it is never night, and the energy density is 10 times higher than we get here on the surface of the Earth. What will that do for the state of human dignity on our planet? Go to the next slide. I'm not the only one with this idea and this vision. There's a whole crowd of people. We've helped gather them together into a little club we call the Cislunar Marketplace. There's over 200 companies, universities, entrepreneurs that want to go forth and make this happen. There's a sample of some of our partners in there. We're about to have another big event in New York this year where we will do more studies and generate more papers. That'll be cool. All right, go to the next slide. Now I'm going to change gears for a minute. I'm going to come back to Mars because I told you it is not the Lunar Gateway. It's the Mars Gateway. We can't practically and safely send people to Mars today. There is a lot more research to be done to figure out how to do that in a way that we don't harm them. And we need to do that in a deep space facility, like Gateway, which happens to be sitting next to the moon, because that's a twofer. And I'm going to talk a little bit about why that is. I'm going to pick on one of the challenges that many of you in this room know about when we talk about extended duration of time where we put people out in deep space. So go to the next slide. Let's talk about radiation. All right, so we're going to work our way up. I'm plotting on the vertical dose equivalent for you, so millisieverts, this radiation that's making it into your body, it's kind of jumbled and averaged out together because different kinds of radiation do different things to your tissues. But in general, we can look at it this way. That first little bar is the cosmic radiation that makes it through our planet's magnetosphere, makes it through our atmosphere, which is a great radiation shield, equivalent roughly to like 30 feet of water, pretty good stuff. And down to you, this is what you're getting probably in the room right now, about a third of a millisievert. I get more than that because I live at 7,000 feet, Colorado. But that's what we're getting. And so when we put that together with all the other stuff in our environment, you know, natural materials, x-rays, and the people sitting next to you, and if you eat bananas, all of that kind of stuff, works its way all the way up to about 3.5. And that's fine. Biological systems are awesome. They are self-repairing. And of course, this ionizing radiation, so radiation as you guys know, with a certain level of energy, at least 10 EV, will ionize. It'll strip electrons. It'll disrupt molecules. When your cells are getting hit with this right now in this room, some of your cells are being damaged, and some of them are dying. And your body has no problem with that. It's either repairing them or replacing them, and you will go on, and none of this will matter. Let's go another build. Here's an abdominal scan, 8 millisieverts. This is why your radiological technician is wearing a lead apron whenever they are doing this for you. By the way, living in Colorado and putting a couple hundred hours on an airplane every year, I get a lot more. I'm closer to 5. So you guys, you know, cut me some slack here today. All right, now let's get out and see some references. So if your daily life, if your job exposed you to something in the neighborhood of 20 or more millisieverts every year, you're going to get classified and regulated radiation worker by the, you know, Energy Commission. And you're probably going to wear a dosimeter to work every day, and they're going to make sure you're safe. And you are. You're totally safe at that level. Go to the next one. Okay, if you do a 6-month tour on ISS, you're around 70 to 80. That's above that. In fact, it's even above the annual limit we would allow a radiation worker to be exposed to. But that's okay too, because you're not going to live on the space station. You're going to be there a handful of times over your career if you're an astronaut with NASA. And you're closely monitored, so that's fine. And you are below where the stochastic cancer threshold exists. It's well accepted at about 100 millisieverts per year, where you would have a measurable increase in your risk of contracting a variety of cancers, because some of those cells didn't get damaged, didn't die, they mutated and they became cancerous. So you're below that, and that's cool. Go to the next slide. Now let's do a 6-month transit to Mars. Okay, well, that's quite a bit more if we're not protecting you during that transit. And you're not going to spend 6 months going to Mars and 6 months coming back to Mars and not stay. So you're going to put about a year on the surface, and that's the standard reference that NASA is working to for a mission to Mars. So that's that effect. And so let's go ahead and build up the whole mission. So there you are. There's 1 year out, 1 year on, 1 year, you know, 6 months out, 1 year there, 6 months back, 2 years. Where is that cancer limit again? Oh, that's pretty far down the scale. And so without protection, you send 5 or 10 people, you know, 1 or 2 of them are going to come back with cancer. And if you do that all the time, you can pretty much guarantee that. So this is something we have to deal with before we go to Mars. Go to the next slide. Oh, yeah, did I mention proton storms? So solar particle events. Periodically, if you're not familiar with this phenomenon, our sun decides to blast a giant death ray of radiation off its surface out into space. And now, if you happen to be in front of that death ray, we're not talking millisieverts. We start measuring things in sieverts. And along that timeline, which is to scale, are some of the known ones, beginning with the Carrington event back in 1859, that set telegraph stations on fire spontaneously. A little bit later, we had the geomagnetic storm of 1921, where we had telephones then, and telephones quit working for a day or two. And then the next storm that we are aware of in 1938, transatlantic radio stopped working for about 12 hours. And then we kind of fast forward. The one that kind of really holds my attention is that next storm, the solar storm of August of 72, because Apollo 16 went in April. And then the storm hit in August, and then 17 went in December. It was a pretty powerful storm. It's considered one of the most dangerous storms to humans in space at the time. Had they been there, sea mines were spontaneously detonated in the ocean as a result of this, for example. Those astronauts would have certainly been injured and possibly would have been killed had they happened to have been in space in front of that blast in August instead of in April and December. So that's kind of a big deal, dodged a bullet there. Then you can see more. Then we roll forward to the Hubble servicing mission back in 99. I'm pretty sure that Sonny Williams, our astronaut who's going up this year on Atlas, was in that mission outside the station, and that's the Bastille event that occurred a few months later. and so on. You get the message. That graph in the bottom is prompt exposure. I was showing you slow exposure on the previous set of slides. And so at 2 sieverts, you're going to get hurt. You're going to get burned. You're going to vomit. You're going to have diarrhea. You might lose some vision. You're going to be injured. Now we get it up to 4 sieverts. 60% of the people die without medical attention. By the time you hit 8 sieverts, everybody dies. We don't have a lot of data for this. We're pretty sure of that. Most of that data comes from Chernobyl. Anybody watch the TV show? Few scientific inaccuracies, but you get the idea. So we got to deal with that too. That's also part of it because we're talking about having people in space for a year. And we're talking about having them on the surface of a planet without a magnetosphere or much of an atmosphere to speak of either. And we're going to do it over and over. Sooner or later, we're going to get caught by one of these if protecting them and planning for it. So next slide. But good news. We're studying the heck out of the sun. I think year before last, we put Parker up. Super exciting mission. Data coming in. If you haven't seen the data, you should look at it. It is super cool. Last month, we put the European complementary mission solar orbiter that will be at an inclined orbit so it can see the poles really for the first practical time. And of course, as I said, the gateway, the Mars gateway, is going to put a station in deep space exposed to this. Big difference from ISS. When you're in ISS experiencing the radiation that is there inside the Earth's ionosphere, it's like being outside on a pleasant summer day in the sun. Very different in comparison to the freaking giant microwave oven that exists in deep space on the moon and at the Gateway Station where we can effectively research this before we commit people to a Mars mission. And once we let them go from the rocket, I mean, that's a year. You can't get them back, even if they decide not to land. You go and you come back. There's no way to really fix that that's practical. So the research that gets done here is going to make it practical for us to go to Mars. Go to the next slide. Back up. Thank you. So you guys, a lot of you guys who are familiar with radiation are familiar with our current practical understanding of how to shield for it. The stuff on the left just gives you a little bit of feel for what's called the quality factor. Remember I said these sievert levels are kind of all wrapped together, and this is what kind of makes it into your body, but they all affect your organs in different ways. This is one of the ways that you compute that as you're working your way down to the calculation of damage to a specific organ. It's called quality factor, and just roughly speaking, an alpha particle of radiation, for example, which is a helium nucleus, is about 20 times more harmful than a beta particle, which are electrons or positrons. That's what that means. But good news is, you know, alpha particles can be shielded with a piece of paper. Awesome. Beta, you can shield with thin aluminum. That sounds like a spacecraft shell, so that's not too bad. Gamma, well, lead, other thick metals. That's getting a little less practical. Neutrons are more of a thing here in the nuclear power industry than in space, but still, and they also have the potential not just for secondary radiation, but to make other things radioactive. So that's a problem. And of course, finally, what we're really talking about are cosmic rays, which are really a big soup of all of the stuff that's above it. And typically at much higher power levels. So in a way, this is a little deceptive because a cosmic ray alpha particle that's originated, say, outside our solar system has a lot more energy and may actually penetrate right through the aluminum and into your body. That's pretty rough stuff. And you can see the common ways we shield with that is concrete, lots of water, boron, stuff like that. Now, I can tell you, as a honest-to-God person who designs and builds rockets for a living, a rocket scientist, that lead and concrete are not our preferred materials for spacecraft. This ain't going to cut it. We're going to need some new materials that are a lot more efficient at shielding out this radiation. You know, plastics with a lot of hydrogen. There's all kinds of stuff started, but nothing that we could use today to safely send people to the red planet and back. This is the research that's going to get done on Gateway and on Artemis and make it possible for us to actually do this instead of just imagining that we could go to Mars tomorrow. All right, go to the next slide, please. All right, so it's another legal requirement that I point out that I have launched 137 times and never once failed to take our mission to space. We're damn proud of that. And finally, I am done with charts, I think, and can take any questions you might have. Do I have time for that? All right. Thank you. So if you ask me any hard ones, I'm going to give them to Sowers.
Okay.
Or Robbie. Robbie seems to have this nailed.
Tori, thanks for your vision of the trillion-dollar cislunar economy. One thing that we've seen in all the presentations, ISRU, habitation, surface mobility, they all depend on power.
Yes.
And I'm just curious, what are your thoughts on putting power plants on the moon, sort of if you build it, they will come type thing, because every process that we're talking about needs power.
Yeah.
And I think if we look at holistically what you want to do in a cislunar economy, there's going to be a lot of power needs.
Yeah. So I'm going to sort of use simplistic analogies. So when the Industrial Revolution got going in the Western world, you know, we started with things like water power. That's kind of equivalent to using solar on the moon, where we have, again, so much higher power density than we have available to here on Earth. Thank God, if the power density were 10 times higher on Earth, we'd all be crispy. But also, fortunately, just as the Industrial Revolution moved on to coal and eventually discovered what kerosene was all about, once again, there's 20 billion metric tons of high-energy fuel sitting on the moon. So I think really the essence of your question, though, was really directed at how does this get going? What are the economics of that? And so we're actually off studying that right now. And I will say that I think one of the great opportunities that government has to help start what we've just talked about is the same role government has always had in economic development, which is to pool our resources to create infrastructure that lets this get going. So, for example, we need to mine the propellant on the moon. We need to make it available on the moon. Wouldn't it be cool if we had a strategic lunar propellant reserve, not unlike the petroleum reserve that we hold in Texas? That would, through public-private partnership, because there is a business case for private companies to participate in that, just not the entire one on day one, to build that infrastructure, to mine the ice on the moon, to refine it into propellant, to use that then in power stations to provide electricity for the other activities we want to do on the moon, and let private industry sell the excess capacity to its commercial customers that then want to run out to the near-Earth objects and prospect them and eventually develop them and so on. So I think it's really about government helping to kickstart through infrastructure the economic activities that will follow. Is there a hand over here? Yes.
Yeah, Tony. Gary Barnhart, XISP Inc. Excellent presentation. But one of the things that we've heard earlier is this notion of increasing the velocity of decision making. Okay. What's, in your mind, the most concrete step that can be taken in the next year that will make a difference to moving towards the goal of the cislunar economy?
In the next 12 months. Yeah. So the first, I'm going to give you a couple of different things, and some of them will sound more exciting than others. The first thing is to embrace the Artemis program. This is finally our opportunity where the government has said, here is a major multi-billion dollar commitment to put permanent infrastructure on the moon. Quit squabbling over whether or not near rectilinear halo orbit is perfect, or any of this other stuff, and get behind the damn program and row the rowboat. That's number one. There's always a better way, but now's the time to move. So we want to build that momentum, get this in place, and in advance of that first lunar polar research station looking at ice and how to manufacture propellant, we need to start working the policy piece of this, because I'm talking about private industry in space, the self-sustaining commercial economy. that will make it impossible for us to just plant a flag and go home when we get bored. But you can't have a business, God forbid, I'm going to have to say it, you can't have business without regulation. Where's Bob? You know this. It plays a part. You have to have the right to go out and put your ice mining claim in place, own that, have the right to mine it, have the right to sell what you pull out. We don't really have that legal framework now. It's ambiguous. What's to stop somebody from jumping your claim? And, you know, all of that. What's to stop someone from behaving irresponsibly in orbit where the things are different? I mean, we know about navigation of the seas and not, you know, leaving hulks in people's way, but it's different in orbit, orbital velocities. You can do all kinds of irresponsible things up there that will make it impossible for anybody to do business. So I'll give you those two. All right. Yes, ma'am.
Can you tell me where you come up with the number of 20 billion metric tons? Where'd you come up with that number?
I can tell you where I came up with the number. So NASA has a number of papers, and they all have different numbers, and we kind of averaged it. But this is why we're going to go. But hey, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's 10 billion metric tons. Gosh, there'll only be 500,000 years worth of propellant. Who else?
Well, one more here. This is Clive Neal again. Keep talking about resources and the water ice on the moon as if it's all there and we can get it. We don't know that. We really don't know that. So it's great to have those sorts of numbers up there. But there may be 20 billion tons of water on the moon, but how much can be extracted? What is the reserve potential, i.e. economically extractable water ice that can be used and produced for a profit? That's what we're talking about in this space economy. It's one of the big things, I think, is the essential next step for that trillion-dollar economy. We've got to go prospecting. We've got to figure out where the richest ones are that are extractable, that we can get to. Shackleton Crater looks great. You can't get in it. It's a very steep slope. So we have to look elsewhere. There are places on the moon, maybe not at the South Pole, but there are places where we can do that. It's the essential next step to put that vision, actually make it work, to know that we have reserves rather than resources. So we use resources and reserves interchangeably here. They're not the same. So we have to be careful. And I think we really need to push to understand that that is real potential. Right now, it's potential. And so I think that's an essential thing for this group to think about. Can we actually start getting data that will initiate that type of economy? And that's going to be game changing.
So I'm not sure there was a question there, but I let you go on because that was perfect. That's exactly why we need to get this program in place, get onto the moon, and do the research. That's why we need to do this. Am I out of time?
Yes.
Hey, thank you, everybody. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tori. We have, this is... In strategy, you often aim for a goal that is beyond what you need to do right now. And this kind of vision and direction, I think, is the story that we need to be talking about so that the things that we do now are actually significant progress. So thank you very much. This kind of ambition drives all of us. And whether or not the resources are extractable or not is a wide open question, and there are a thousand other wide open questions. So next we have Arizona State University's Neal Woodbury. I'd like to welcome Neal up to the podium. I've been following ASU's investment and growth, very ambitious growth in space research, science, and engineering since my days on the Messenger mission here at the Applied Physics Lab. And for the last decade or so, I've been very pleased to see ASU's very deliberate embracement of the new space world, of the entrepreneurial outgrowth, the new startups, and the way that ASU has invested in their researchers and their facilities to be a national asset for space research. APL is one, Caltech and JPL is another. There are universities from coast to coast that provide resources and talent to NASA and to the nation for this area. And the way that ASU has stepped up and said, we also want to be this. We want to push on this I think is an example for all of the universities who have the ability to grow in this area. They saw this growth, I think, and committed to it before it was a really big thing that most of the nation believed in. They started this path that they're on before the first Falcon 9 launch, which was a game changer. I mean, a big difference in the world. All of a sudden, there's a new player in the market who's launching at that scale. That was a big deal. But they got into this and said, let's see what we can do to get started even before that happened. And so I'm very pleased that they're here. We're very pleased that they've offered to host the fall meeting that we'll all go to down in Arizona, down in Phoenix. And so let me introduce Neal real quickly. Neal Woodbury received his bachelor's from UC Davis and his PhD from Washington in Seattle in 1986. He performed his postdoc research at the Carnegie Institution in Washington and then later at Stanford University. He joined the chemistry and biochemistry department, now the School of Molecular Sciences, at Arizona State University in 1998. He currently serves as the Chief Science and Technology Officer at ASU, as a professor in the School of Molecular Sciences, and as a faculty member in the Center for Innovations in Medicine and the ASU Biodesign Institute. And he's also co-founder of the company HealthTel. Please welcome Neal to the podium with me, please. Thank you. This is for you. And I'm going to click this, and your slides are good. You can either change it with that or the space bar.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you, and it's really great to be here. We're very excited to be part of this, and it's really been a great gathering, and I've learned a tremendous amount. First, I want to thank NASA, Niki, and Jim, and APL, Michael, for putting all this together. We really appreciate that. We've been communicating back and forth in various different ways, and this exceeds my expectations by a great deal. So I'm really pleased with what's happened here. Second thing I'll say is that you'll notice the top person on the list on my slide. Many of you know that's Lindy Elkins-Tanton. She really wanted to be up here giving this talk, which would have actually been better than a biochemist giving this talk. But that's okay. She is running the Psyche mission, as I think many of you know. And this week happened to be an extraordinary week for that mission, and she couldn't be in more than three or four places at the same time. So I am here in her stead, and very happy to be here. This has been a great meeting. So I had the tremendous pleasure earlier this week and really honor of going into NASA headquarters with my colleague, former Congressman Bob Walker, and meeting with Dr. Lavaro and talking a little bit about going to the moon and what was going to happen on the moon. And I was really impressed with his enthusiasm and his absolute dedication to making this happen on time, happen in the way that has been laid out here. He wears this lapel, for those of you that have gone and see him, and he changes it every day, and it has a different number on it. And that number is the number of days until we have to be back on the moon. And so, he really has this entrepreneurial spirit of, as I co-founded a startup in the health space, and we had a clock on the wall. And it was the clock for the Series A, and it was counting down every day. And that was the same kind of spirit now that they have at NASA. So I think it's very exciting, and I was really happy to see that. Okay, you've seen this already, probably four times already today. These are the things that we've got to solve if we're going to get there and stay there, probably more importantly for these things, stay there. And we need to think about how to do that. And clearly that's going to take a lot of different kinds of players at many different TRL levels to figure this out. Because some of them we already have partial solutions to. We need to figure out how to manufacture and move forward with them. Other things, we really don't know how it's going to happen. And we're going to have to do some very fundamental research to figure that out and work forward. So the universities, as part of this consortium, can help with a lot of those kinds of problems. And ASU is really committed to that and committed to the idea that we can take things a little farther rather than just writing a nice paper and handing it to you guys and saying good luck. We can take it a little bit farther than that and really, really work on how do we get directly involved with the commercial partners, with national labs, with NASA, to move these things in smoothly from conception all the way through. So I won't run through them because we already have, but we will want to talk a little bit about how we go about doing this. What are the kinds of things that we're going to have to do? Well, education is clearly going to be a big deal here because we want to stay there. If we want to stay there, we actually have to educate the next group of people that's going to come along and help us make this happen. And what's better way to educate them than to involve them in the process of getting there directly? And so what we've been doing, what many of our partner universities have been doing, is engaging our students directly in the process. So we've got students that are out there building CubeSats and setting them up, and students sitting in front of panels and collecting data as it comes back from Mars and this kind of stuff. So it's happening in real time, and the students are actually making the decisions and working on things. Research is obviously going to be a major aspect of this, but research not in the sense that academics normally do research. We often, I'm afraid, do research in the way of meandering about and looking at this and looking at that, which is great. I'm all for it. I love that kind of work, leading whatever threads there. But in this case, it's going to have to be much more directed. We're really going to have to work with partners to do much more directed problem-solving research. And that's something that at ASU we've been doing quite a bit of, and working with partners both in university and elsewise to accomplish that. And that comes to this engagement issue. We've got to be engaged. We've got to be connected to lots of other groups and make sure that that connection is real and available. And then the same is true with this communication. So we will be happy to be one of the elements working with APL, working with NASA, to make sure the entire community is involved, and not just the community that is normally involved in this process, but the community. I mean, I happen to be a biochemist. Well, if you're going to put people up there, we're actually going to have to figure out how their metabolism is going to work and how all kinds of other things are going to work when they're up there. So we're going to have to be able to reach out into places we haven't reached out to before. So what are some of the ways we do this at ASU? First of all, you've got to get everybody involved at the top of the university. You've got to, all this talk of, well, we're not going to do things the academic way. That's not me. That's President Michael Crow. He is absolutely committed to changing the way in which we think about research in a university and the ability not to get rid of some of that other more broad research areas, but to add to that the capability of taking that creative chaos and focusing it on real-world problems and moving them forward. And that's been a thesis in his 17 years as president, and he's done that unabashedly. And then there's Lindy, who I think many of you know, who is running our interplanetary program, and she's done a fantastic job of that. So we have a few different organizations at ASU I'll just point out. We have a whole school, which is the School of Earth and Space Exploration. So that tells you something about ASU. We are devoted to this topic. We train students. They get degrees in this area. That's what they do. Lindy ran that school for quite a while and set it up and made it work. And they are involved in many, many different kinds of missions. So they run the Psyche mission, or Lindy runs the Psyche mission as the PI. But there's another 21 missions that they're involved in with lots and lots of partners, many of whom are in this room. We have the Interplanetary Initiative, which is the overarching initiative that Lindy runs, which thinks about both the Psyche mission and many other aspects, but they're really thinking about what is the future of humans in space. And if you're going to do something about the future of humans in space, you've got to think about partnerships with industry. Our New Space Initiative is all about partnership with industry. How do we think about what the role of space will be in commercial enterprise, and how should universities be interfacing with that in order to make it go forward? Jim Bell runs that initiative and does an excellent job, and I think probably many of you know him. And then we have one of the largest engineering schools in the entire country. And again, they are feeding this effort and building things associated with it. Lots of sensors, lots of robots, lots of autonomous widgets of various different kinds that we're going to need when we're there. And of course, everything is about partnerships if you want this to move forward. So this is just a couple of examples. This is the New Space Initiative that Jim Bell runs. This particular part of it is run by Craig Hargrove. And this is something that just came up. We're going to have to figure out where the water is, right? So where is the water? The water is where the hydrogen is. So they are mapping the hydrogen on the surface of the moon. And they're doing it with a little shoebox-sized CubeSat that's running around looking for the hydrogen and making a map of that system. So again, this is the kind of thing that the students are involved in, everybody's involved in, so they're learning as we go along as well. Interplanetary Initiative, we do not just the technical side of things, but very much the education side of things and the thinking about the larger picture. So we have a whole curriculum based on satellite command and control. How do you do that? What does that involve? That's not just building a satellite, right? That's running things. That's managing things. How do you do all that? We have to have students that learn that kind of process. So we have this curriculum that's set up now, and they're not only building these things and taking data from these things, they're figuring out how all the control processes take place. So now, partnerships. So we've got 80 private sector companies we're working with, 30 different universities and research centers, and 20 government agencies and centers. And this is the only way this stuff gets done. And we like to do it this way. We like to work with everybody else. And this is part of our mantra. And again, part of our president's requirement of ASU. He says, this is what you've got to do. You've got to partner and get these things done. So how are we going to move forward? How are we going to do some of this stuff? We've heard a little bit about this already today, talking about what will happen next. We're going to have to start thinking about what the projects are that we're going to be going forward with. We're very happy to work with NASA and APL and try to coordinate some of these projects in terms of how we get people involved with them. And then through the next 6 months or so, be thinking through how these projects will work and which projects we're going to focus on. And then at the fall meeting, which I hope all of you will come to Arizona, which is a very nice place in the fall, maybe not in August, but in the fall, it's a beautiful place to be. Come and see us there and work with us. And at that point, we'll have a much more focused meeting on a specific area or set of areas that we'll be focusing down on trying to get real solutions for. How do we do this sort of thing? This is something Lindy in particular has really worked out within Interplanetary. Different ways of running these kinds of projects that allow you to move quickly from the brainstorming session to some kind of a prototype and testing situation. And then from there, of course, you move it out into more and more tests and start interfacing with the people that are actually going to make the stuff and work with it in the real space. This is the sort of timeline or the map of how that works. You have a team that sits down with a vision. They come up with many different possible solutions, and I think this is very important. And they mull those over for a while. They explore each of those for a period of time. And by period of time, we're talking days, not months or years, right? So this is a very intense process. They then finally down select to one and quickly try to build some kind of prototype that they can start to test. Get some kind of data. Don't make it perfect. Get some kind of data so that you have some idea which things are just stupid. And you can get rid of them and keep going on and move forward. Then you move to the pilot project where you're actually using some of these things more rigorously and testing them out. And hopefully what that will lead to then is teams in a very good position to go to funded projects that NASA will have available and give very strong proposals and move forward rapidly. Okay. So what comes out of these, you get these rapid prototyping capability. And the idea is that you, in the minimal amount of time and the minimal amount of effort, get the best quality possible products coming out of the system. Do it fast, figure out what they are, and run that process in an efficient way. Then from the output of the pilot projects, you want to have things that feed directly into the BAAs and RFPs that are put out that we're going to be competing for and working together on. So I really, again, appreciate being here. I think this has been a really educational experience for me, seeing all the different people involved. As universities, I think we can play a key role in this process, and not just ASU, but many, many universities in this process, and to help develop some of the innovation that needs to happen quickly. And then we're all about, as I said, collaboration and making things work. And then finally, we've got to create the workforce that's going to go on and on and on over the next decades and keep this thing going. And that's what we're also absolutely committed to doing. And I thank you very much for your attention.
So if we have any questions for Neal, we have a few minutes we can take to do that.
So you showed a very successful process for getting involved in missions and technology development. You mentioned you were a biochemist, so I'm wondering if you think that same process will work for initiatives in space medicine and things that are really important with regard to human exploration from a health point of view.
Okay, sorry. Yes, so now the concept of a prototype in that space is a little bit different than the concept of a prototype in some of the other, you know, if you're building a sensor, but you can still do the same kinds of things. And in fact, when you're building a biotech company, that's more or less precisely what you're doing. So yeah, you can use the same kinds of approaches. It'll depend on the context in which you're trying to do it. Now we have, for example, I don't know if you're interested in that area, you might know Cheryl Nickerson at ASU, who's been working very hard on what the effects of biological cell systems are in space. And so she does these kinds of things. And again, because of the way you have to run it in space, she's got to set it up such that it's a very fast cycle process, because it goes up, comes down, she has to have the answer. So yeah, we do have some experience running that kind of thing in that arena as well.
Join me in thanking Neal.
Okay, thank you very much.
One of the areas that I hope the consortium can really bring a leveling or a sustaining factor to the industry is in the area of education. When I graduated with my aerospace degree, there were only 11 other aerospace engineers on the podium with me when I graduated because of the dip in the aerospace industry at the time. And the university that I was at wasn't really pushing hard to make sure that that was an area that continued. Perhaps through this consortium, we can remind universities that space takes a long time, and even when dips come, we need folks who can do this kind of work. So thank you, Neal. Next, we're going to hear from the third of these three perspectives that I alluded to earlier, and that's from David Wilson at Bechtel. David is the Chief Innovation Officer and a Principal Vice President for Bechtel Corporation, which is a 122-year-old private global engineering, procurement, and construction company. They do a lot of different things, but one of the things that you might not know, and I am still kind of beginning to understand the depth of Bechtel's experience in space, is that they're not a newcomer to the space industry. They've been working on space projects for decades. And in fact, I think we'll hear at least a little bit about a recent award that Bechtel received exactly in this area, right in the middle of everything that we've been talking about for the last day. And this idea of a sustained presence on the moon or anywhere for humans, for our robotic systems, is dependent upon what we build, the infrastructure, the architecture necessary to make it happen. The idea of a large-scale architecture and development effort on the moon doesn't require the Hoover Dam at the beginning in terms of power infrastructure, but it does require some power that is going to be larger than a simple battery pack or a few solar cells. And so we're going to hear a little bit about their thoughts on these large issues when it comes to lunar exploration. David's held various technical positions and operational positions in his 19 years at Bechtel. He's a mechanical engineering graduate of the University of Utah and holds his master's degree in engineering and technology management from Washington State University. He's also a registered professional engineer and a certified Lean Six Sigma and innovation expert. So join me with welcoming David to the podium.
Thank you. It's great to be here. Glad to be included.
You're good.
Good.
Forgot to do this for you. There you go.
Awesome. Again, great to be here. I think I'm the non-traditional representative for the group, not new space, not old space, not middle-aged space, the entirely non-traditional space, if you will. So we're creating a whole new category. So anybody else wants to join, we can talk after. Non-traditional space, it's a whole new wave. I will say, and Michael shared my bio, my background, I am a mechanical engineer. I was going to say I'm not a rocket scientist, just as the fine print for this presentation goes, not a planetary scientist. I took a physics class as a part of my degree. And if it helps, I both read and watched The Martian. That makes a difference. Just to give you some perspective about what I'm coming into this discussion with, I will bring a builder's perspective, a construction perspective. You've got a bit of the background of Bechtel, and I'll go into some more detail about that, how that relates to this discussion about space development, surface development, both on the moon and on Mars, and how does that all fit together? Oh, also, if you'd like, you can feel free to harass me on Twitter, and then follow Bechtel on Twitter if you'd like to as well. So if you've got questions or want to offer feedback during the presentation, feel free to do that on Twitter. So a bit about Bechtel, we get the context about 122 years. I think a couple points to make. It's private, fifth generation. Why is that significant? Because our horizon is not dictated by earnings calls or quarterly reporting. It is a much longer horizon. In fact, our current CEO, for all intents and purposes, will be CEO for the next 30 years. So long horizon, big vision, able to invest in that multi-generational plan, multi-year plan. And that's important as we talk about space, because it's not going to be 2 years, it's going to be 4 years, and then 8 years, and then 20 years, and then 30 years. And so that's an important fact. We are organized in four verticals. We are organized in a nuclear security and environmental business. So fun fact, we've built 80% of North America's nuclear power. And I think Tori actually even brought up Chernobyl as a complex project. We actually built the containment unit around Chernobyl. So when it comes to first of a kind projects, we have lots of experience doing first of a kind. I would not argue that the first of a kind on Earth is as complex as the first of a kind on the moon, but every job that's first of a kind is a stepping stone towards reducing the complexity, reducing the unknowns, and advancing something that's more feasible, more practical in space, both moon and then Mars. We have an oil and gas business unit where we produce and build LNG facilities. We've also done 50,000 miles of pipeline and lots of petrochemical projects. Then we have an infrastructure business where we do roads, rails, airports, and civil projects of a variety of communication projects, as well as combined cycle projects, and then a mining and metals business where we build copper, alumina, and aluminum facilities. And why does that matter? Well, when we talk about what infrastructure is needed for the moon and what infrastructure is needed for Mars, it's going to absolutely have components. And Niki brought it up, you know, the infrastructure components. Where is the power going to come from? How is the power going to get distributed? How are things going to maneuver on the surface? What's going to be there for launch and landing? And then how are we going to mine and produce propellants? So we work with owner operators to produce those mines. We work with owner operators to set up the infrastructure to then operate those facilities for continued development of that ecosystem. Michael did bring it up. We've been involved where, you know, while I'd say non-traditional, we have been involved in the space areas for a number of years, going back into the 60s, whether it's with research and study projects or it's actually at launch complexes, the work we've done at Vandenberg, work we've done at Marshall, at Kennedy. The most recent award was for Mobile Launcher 2 scope that we're doing at Kennedy today. In fact, we've got a team on the ground there. continued management of Arnold Air Force Base, the Arnold Research Center. And so the point there is we've been around and we've contributed to a lot of studies. The thing that I learned actually in putting this slide together is the engagement of our technical experts in the studies that were done in 2000 to 2006 around lunar habitat, architecture, and design. So, you know, we've been around, we've participated. While we wouldn't be considered new, old, or middle-aged, we've been adapting and contributing to this journey for a number of years. And on the subject of studies, and I think the topic was a little intimidating when we talk about lunar architecture, because a lot has been done around lunar architecture. A lot of studies have been published, a lot of reports have been developed, you know, all the way back into the 40s and 50s. And so there is a lot of quality input. And for the purposes of copyright, I didn't put some of the more recent renderings and studies that have been done, because there's actually a lot of great work that's been done in the last few years that could be referenced and pointed back to. What we look at this as, though, as we think about our execution projects, these research studies and reports and architectures and designs are really that first phase of input that we would ingest and incorporate into a broader plan. So this would all inform what are the requirements, what are the conceptual designs. That becomes input for us to drive into a master plan. And so for us on executing projects on Earth, we take this master planning approach and think it actually has relevance to development in space, whatever the objective be. And as a part of that process, it's an overlap of many things. And when you talk to people about master planning, a lot of times it goes right to city planning and into architectural detail. Those are components of it. But when we think about master planning, it's what's the objective? What's success? How do we define what that looks like? What are the environmental factors, the constraints, whether it's space, plot, site conditions? Do we know where we're going to go? Do we have alternate locations for where we're going to go? And then I think a core aspect of this that I think we've talked about a lot today, but it's one we can go into in more detail, is what's the financial modeling? What justifies going to that location to do that thing? And it's going to create that sustainable ecosystem that's not going to have to be subsidized by a government agency for perpetuity. And so looking at that and applying that to our projects, as well as the engineering, as well as the architecture, as well as the systems engineering. And the other component of this that's really important is the risk mitigation and identification. Anytime you're doing something unknown or first of a kind, there are risks. And you can only, at best, plan to address those and attack those and mitigate those as you advance through understanding what are the knowns and what are the unknowns. So developing a master plan that has the ability to flex and pivot as you identify what you know and what you don't know, and then evolve as you go. And to give you some context, we've done this. So this, the point of this and the point of how we then apply this to space will be one of the next slides. We've been in Jubail in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia for the past 50 years. It started as a master plan. If you look at the far right, you can see in the bottom, it started as a desert. There was nothing there. It was a barren plot of ground. And the kingdom wanted to invest in creating a sustainable marketplace that could drive industry. They had a fixed amount of resources that they could invest in the development. We developed a plan and have been there for the last 50 years to develop that. And if you see the data point there, that city that didn't exist 40 or 50 years ago now produces 7% of the kingdom's GDP. So again, creating that sustainable marketplace from a seed investment by the government through a structured plan that was both designed but then executed. And so that's the nuance of master planning by a builder is really done to go execute it. And so we're largely technology agnostic. That is where I think this room adds a ton of value with the academic research that's been done and was talked about, the work that NASA has done around technology and technology readiness and development. We as a builder are technology agnostic. We want to develop something that can be built and then executed as a part of this ecosystem. A couple other examples. I think the one in the middle is pretty interesting. The country of Gabon came and said, we have some natural resources. We'd like to invest those natural resources in developing a plan for the country. So a country level master plan to develop what's their infrastructure look like, what's their economy look like, where do they invest, how do they structure it, how do they bring in more investment to help advance this plan, and then how does that then get built, both roads, the rails, the power, the industry, to sustain that country based on a fixed amount of resources to begin with. And so you see the numbers there. It's another 20 billion plus project that continues to evolve and grow. And so a few examples, and the reason I share that is because we think the same approach has application when we start to think about harsher environments or more complex projects. This project is a hydroelectric facility in the middle of Canada. So I will never argue that the cold weather winters of Canada are equivalent to the lunar surface, but I will say it has some challenges nonetheless. Your construction season is limited, but there are ways around that. So the cold is very oppressive. Equipment and machinery, as we know, don't work well in the cold. And so how do you attack that? How do you address that? How do you work around that? So this is a project where we developed a plan. There were unknowns. We've worked those elements of the plan and continue to advance this project, which really is a first of a kind for a couple of reasons. And I think the relevance of this, and a reason I wanted to bring it up, is this hydroelectric facility is built entirely with resources sourced locally. So all of the material that's gone into the concrete, all of the material that's gone into the site prep, all that is sourced locally out of borrow pits that are there. So they didn't take anything in. They're actually building wholly with resources developed at that location. So we think about the moon. You know, we're limited in how much we can take to the moon, limited with how much we can take to Mars. So how do you develop these approaches? While they might be different, there are certain things we can build on, the autonomous component, the robotics component, you know, using resources that are locally available. And you can see this is 10 degrees south of the Arctic. The other aspect of this that I thought was unique is they actually moved the river to build this. So that river that you see in that bottom right-hand side there, it didn't naturally flow that direction. They had to move the river to build the hydroelectric facility, and then they're going to move the river back. So if you think about that, you're moving a river, just to be clear. And then you're building a hydroelectric facility in the middle of Canada, where it's very cold and equipment doesn't operate. So there are things from this that we can learn, we think, that can apply to lunar surface construction. And again, anytime you're doing first of a kind, there are unknowns, but every prior first of a kind leads to learning that can be applied in the future. So that brings us to our approach, and this is a simplification of the approach. I kind of talked about it. You know, you ingest the research and studies that have been done in the past. You identify the requirements. What's the objective? Is it sustained presence? Is it research? Is it sustainable economic positions? You know, what is that? What's the duration? What's the number? You know, how many people do we expect? What do we expect from a habit, from a population growth? What are the resources the people need? If you think about a camp project where we go and build that hydroelectric facility in Canada, that has gyms, it has waste management, it has cafeterias, it has chefs, it has entertainment. All the things you think about, you're going to need on a settlement that's going to have a permanent presence. All these things come into it. So the same thing that we would apply to that facility, we would apply the thinking to a lunar outpost. What do you need? How do you determine what success is? How do you evaluate what technology is the right fit and makes the most sense? And then you advance that into a long-term master plan that is at some level higher and has some options for settlements and for locations, because you'll always want to have a backup and you always want to have the ability to pivot or address other opportunities. And then you go into the detailed short term. So start broad, start long term, start high level, and drive down into the detailed short term plan, and then go execute it. So this all feeds into a plan that would then inform the engineering and the procurement processes and the work of technology development to support that plan. And along the way, things will work and things won't work. But because you have the plan, you can pivot from it and advance that long-term objective in a deliberate and structured fashion. And so we've started putting some blocks together based on how. So you're going to look at this and say, I disagree with that. That's the wrong sequence. That should be there, or that should be over there. Fair. I'll take that feedback. Part of this is we put this on a piece of paper to help us understand and think through logically, how is a settlement going to get built for a sustained presence top to bottom? So if you look at the graphic, top to bottom is a simplification of how it gets built. And then left to right is, how do we see things feeding forward from Earth to the moon to Mars? And an important point for that, for us as industry, there's also the feedback component that we haven't talked as much about today. So to bring industry investment and engagement, having that vision, that long-term plan is critically important. But how do we feed that learning back into commercialization opportunity on Earth? How does that commercialization feed further R&D, further investment? An investment that's going to be 10 to 15 years in the future, and I know we talk about propellant generation on the moon. I agree. I think that's a grand vision. But how does the technology that's going to enable that actually allow companies to make money on Earth in the next 3 years or less that can then feed investment in further discovery and further advancement? When you talk about the equipment providers and the large companies that run operations on the Earth, their margins are not substantial. And so when you think about long-term investments with a payoff that's far into the future, we have to look at how can technology feed into today's applications to create revenue and opportunity. How does that feed to the moon, and how does that feed to Mars? And so a couple of things in this graphic just to bring to your attention. We started to flag where are there commercial activities today. So when you talk about the commercial transport, you can see commercial transport, there are clearly participants and companies driving that, but there's not as much that I've seen, and correct me if I'm wrong, around the commercial mining. You know, who's in? We talked about the mining. I think somebody asked the question about having a mining forum. You know, where is that? Where is that clear activity that the mining companies of Earth are advancing and understand how to commercialize the mining on Moon and then Mars? And maybe it's happening. I just have not seen it. You think about the in-situ resource utilization. The Centennial Challenge was fantastic for us. We participated because it gave us an opportunity to see how new construction practices on the Moon actually could inform construction practices on Earth. That is a good example of, I think, further application of in-situ resource utilization here. That just needs to be commercialized and monetized, which is still in the process of evolving to that end state. And then you get into the robotics and the habitats. And so I think there are other opportunities to grow the financial model around commercialization to include other partners and other non-traditional organizations in this long-term plan. So with that, I will thank you for the time and thank you for the opportunity to be here and offer a different perspective. So hopefully that was interesting and helpful.
You had a couple of, in the projects that you listed at the beginning, you had a number of them that were characterized with the government as the ultimate customer and the bill payer. But there were many others that were looked like they were purely commercially driven. The government would have been no more than that, maybe issuing regulations or permits. Does that process look different if you have the government as the ultimate customer versus a purely private commercial or private entity as the process, or does it, or the fundamentals the same?
The fundamentals are the same. I think the difference is in when is the, there's a lot of talk about public-private partnerships, which get interesting from what's the private engagement long-term. And so for us, and I didn't bring it up on the hydroelectric facility, that's actually a partnership for, with us, with Bechtel and two other companies that bring expertise that we didn't have. So that's for a government, that's for a power utility, but three companies partner to deliver that product and that solution to the power provider. When we work with the government, largely it's a customer base, so operating labs, operating building chemical demil, those are have specific customer components. We have done public-private partnerships for rail projects. And that just comes into who's the partner that's going to own and operate the facility where we might build it. Who's that other partner that would come into it and have that sustained activity to own it and drive it for the government or for the customer?
You've had several different facilities that you've built overseas. And I was wondering, have you used autonomous vehicles? And you know, given the overhead costs of having humans on the moon, a lot of this is going to have to be done by autonomous or robotic vehicles. So, have you? Do you have any experience with that?
Yeah. So we have. So use Chernobyl as an example. Use the kiosk as an example. So we do use autonomous vehicles, especially in mining, where there is the hazard of the location or the repetitive nature of the activity. I think one of the things that we still see as an opportunity for autonomous vehicles is they're very well suited when you can script the path and define the activity and it is a repetitive activity. There's still some challenges with the situational awareness to drive true. Now, a lot of the technology is advancing, but there's still some opportunity there. We use robotics when it comes to dirty work where you're doing nuclear cleanup and you can't be in a black cell. You'd have to use more complex technology to address that. So those are good analogs to moon applications and Mars applications. But the reason I'm here as a chief innovation officer is I think advancing solutions that we can use on the moon and Mars actually drives us to adopt more on Earth. And so I like that long-term vision and that forcing function to develop the technology so that we can then demonstrate it because it will help us execute mines more safely. It'll help us execute cleanup more safely. It removes people from those hazardous activities, and that's high value as we try to drive improved execution.
So on a product, $20 billion project, can you paint like an organizational tree where Bechtel sits in that? Are you guys at the top, or are you partnered with another, you know, someone who's like Bechtel? And how many players and subs are there, and subs of subs and subs of subs and subs of subs of subs?
So it depends, right? So I guess there's not a one answer. It depends on the project. It depends on the location. So in lots of cases, we partner locally because of the access to the talent and the people and the knowledge. And then we bring an expertise in from the mega project execution and then look at the local supply chain. So depending on where the project is at, you know, where can the steel be sourced, who has the craft expertise, who has unique project expertise. And so in the hydroelectric, you know, we do build dams, but there are other people that build lots of dams. And so how do we get them involved to bring in that experience? And in architecture, you know, we'll bring in those. So it would depend on what the execution of the project looks like. And then it's generally a mix of companies that are involved and help deliver it.
Could you give maybe one example? You know, were we talking thousands or hundreds or?
Of companies?
Yeah, in a project that scale and
so we are currently building a project in a rail project in Riyadh Metro Rail. And just as an example, that one had 20 different design, I think more than 20 different design firms that participated in that. So that's design of rail sections and design of rail stations. And so that's just one example of one job that had 20 different design companies participating in the design, that design only. And then we added different partners to help deliver craft and help deliver people. So I'd have to go back. I can answer that question offline in more detail with a specific example if you're interested.
Hey, David. Tristan Helms with First Mode here. This is less of a question, more kind of an appreciation of one of your statements. First Mode is like a small business that is in Seattle that does both space work and mining work. And it really resonated with me, the challenge that you experience, and that you really need to make decisions on this short, like 3-year timeline, and it has to be tied to clear revenue out the other side. And as we, you know, are looking at both space and mining applications, we might find a mining technology or a mining approach that we think could be applicable in this like lunar surface context. But it'll be hard for us to justify the investment it would take to adapt it, because as a small business, you know, survivability is tied to that like immediate revenue. And so you're experiencing it at the scale of Bechtel, like we experience it like at a very small business sale. So I think that's just some good context and a great example that might be pertinent to this audience.
Oh, I think it's a great point. It's a great point. I think some of what was Jim presented earlier about the different ways small companies can engage and participate in NASA's funding, I think are critical. But a massive hurdle is the scaling hurdle. And if you have to wait to the moon to scale, it's going to be really hard to be successful. So the studies and the research are fundamental to get the base technology done. But you're going to need some place to go and scale. And where better to scale than on Earth? Because that's going to battle test a lot of the technology, a lot of the solutions. And so If you haven't tested at scale on Earth, I would be skeptical of going next step to the moon. Just my from a builder's perspective, because a lot of things fall apart at scale.
Given your commitment and experience with the master planning process, what can you offer up in terms of guide points or heuristics that speak to what maximizes or biases a project towards success in the master planning process? And alternatively, what are the characteristics that lead to failure?
Yeah, so I was talking to somebody earlier. I think two things I'd offer to that are very clear is success. If you have a clear definition of what success looks like for the outcome of what you're trying to produce, the product, the project, or the deliverable, that will lead to higher success rates. When you're trying to solve for something with everything for everybody to do all things, it's a solid recipe for things not to work. And so not having a well-defined criteria for what success looks like is adds risk. And I would also say the other component of it is starting out with a known technology as, so when you start out solution specific, you run the risk of designing around a solution, whereas you, if you start toward the requirements and go technology agnostic, solution agnostic, you give your chance, you give yourself an opportunity to consider the full spectrum and potentially advance new technologies and new solutions. So I think designing around a known solution limits you, and not having clear criteria of success is a recipe for trouble.
Yeah, I'll pretend this isn't another question. It's a follow-up. So this world has a huge amount of political swing to it. So defining success is somewhat dependent on national priorities and things like that. What would your recommendation be for working in that environment, if you have one?
So, you know, somebody told me recently, you know, go with data. And I think that's it was unrelated. But when you lay out the master planning, say, if we really think that a success criteria is a sustainable commercial model, then the financial model that goes with that master plan has to be a key component. And if we consider that a key component, then that actually is going to inform what is success look like at the end of the day for the master plan. Do we expect tourism to drive it? Do we expect propellant to drive it? You know, what's the economic model that will sustain this long-term surface development activity? And so if we say that's a good stepping stone, that's going to result in good data that substantiates, you know, what do we focus on? Do we focus on tourism and abandon propellant? Not saying that's the case. Do we focus on propellant and abandon any talk of tourism? I think looking at that model and understanding what's the market, what are the economics of creating that first outpost will drive, I think, the longer-term success criteria that will create some momentum around further development, if that helps.
Thanks.
We got time for one more question, please.
Thank you. Deborah DeMang, PSI. What really resonated with me with the master plan is to have success criteria. I mean, everybody wants to know what success looks like. But to get to that point, you need to have a purpose. And what is the purpose for going back to the moon? What is the purpose for having a sustainable presence? And I haven't heard that clearly articulated. So I'm putting that back out there. What is the purpose? Is it just to go on to Mars? I would just really like to hear that articulated from those who are driving going back to the moon, if possible.
He's not driving.
No, but there are other people in the room who are.
Very slowly.
Let's see. You know, it's a great comment and question as we're going forward and we're establishing the Artemis program and the mission to there. You know, for us, a key component of that is exploration and the use of the moon to demonstrate technologies and learn the science that's there along the way, as well as done to get onto Mars. So right now the agency is going through and laying out that architecture. What's the long-term plan? And as Steve said this morning, in a month or a little more, that's going to start getting introduced and as we go forward. But very clearly, a very big part of going to the moon is as a proving ground to keep going further.
Thank you,
David,
for the presentation.
Thank you. Thanks.
All right.
So we have heard from Bechtel about infrastructure, including financial modeling, which was not something that was lost upon me, but very nice to hear that brought back. ASU is an example of a university as an engine for progress in generation of human capital to sustain this industry. ULA, we heard about this clear vision, this clear statement of the challenges that we face, but also a belief in a really grand future that we can all pursue together. Jim demonstrated for us STMD's commitment to establishing a sustained American presence on the surface of the moon. And Niki talked about the focused areas that LSII is going to work on, is going to help lead and develop to realize this vision of getting back to the moon and staying on the moon for, well, hopefully forever after that. Once we've established a sustained presence, if we can begin to realize the vision that we heard from Tori, then I don't see a real end game to this. It just continues, just like developments here on the Earth do. And so now I want to take the time to hear more from you about what you see as we as a group, as a consortium, can be doing, should be doing. Rachel demonstrated she shared with you the idea of the executive committee and filling the executive committee, establishing these focus groups and beginning quarterly meetings so that we can begin to discuss this and bring the information back to NASA. They'll participate in the quarterly telecons. They'll learn from the quarterly telecons. From those quarterly telecons, we intend to establish routine visits to people who want to share even more with NASA directly and more with the consortium at large. We have a very loose plan for this portion of the discussion. And I really, again, I do mean discussion. Yes, Niki. Yeah, yes, indeed. And that is actually the button I didn't click.
So the one thing we're thinking, the discussion point after I spoke and then Rachel.
Rachel's.
Rachel's. And then we went into lunch and I think we were all really hungry. And Rachel had some great charts for discussion points and some kind of prompts for dialogue.
Yes.
So now that we've all eaten and maybe we're getting past our, there's sugar up there. Everybody's having the post-lunch slump now. We could bring those discussion points back up. And this is the part where we really wanted to hear more from you guys. We'll have the survey as well afterward, but to talk a little more about the mechanics or if there's questions and in terms of how this is going to be value added.
And just to help you understand how this is structured, this first slide is essentially how the consortium can work for you. How can you contribute to this consortium and to the community that we're creating? Do you see impediments or opportunities or challenges with respect to working with focus groups? What kind of focus group activities would be most productive for the consortium and so forth? And the second slide here is about a little bit in the meat of the focus groups themselves, the critical development needs. So let's begin with this discussion about the consortium itself. Please go ahead.
I didn't see standards and standardization on your last list there, but that's the most important part. Interoperability, if you look at every professional organization on this planet, whether it's IEEE, ASME, ASCE, there are standards committees, interoperability.
Okay, so this is an opportunity perhaps for us as a consortium to partner with those other organizations and allow them to do the work that they have established a process for.
They're not going to do it in your area, but the IEEE, for example, has user groups and you can have like space electrical connectors and things like that. And there's an established process within the IEEE to do that. But the thing is, there has to be a champion within the consortium, within this some organization, whether it's STMD, HEOMD, someone has to take that bull by the horn or you're going to get up there and somebody's going to want to plug their rover into a power supply and it's not going to work. And this work has to be done now, not in 2024.
Thank you. Could you use a microphone so the folks online can hear? Wes will bring you one. Thank you.
You know, in the subject of standards and interfaces, the American Society for Civil Engineers, for example, is standing up a committee to look into standards and requirements for terrestrial and space construction activities.
So that's a great example. Thank you. And thank you for the point on standards, because interfaces and commonality is definitely an important thing.
Playing catch up will be hard. Well, one thing I want to clarify, though, too, is we're about getting technologies flown. And so I don't know if it came across really clearly because we've been focused so much on the consortium aspect, but APL is actually serving as a system integrator in general for LSII across all of those areas. So a lot of what we do in terms of getting technologies developed and flown on CLPS and then human lander systems is the interfaces. I think it's more about ICD type things and making sure early in the design process we're communicating that. Just to be clear, STMD doesn't own those interfaces, but again, the coordination with our HEO and our SMD colleagues, I think, and that communication early on is a key part.
Yeah, well, right now in unorbit servicing, there's Converse, they're doing standards, but and everybody says it's somebody else's job, but we've got to get a handle on this, and we've got to do it now.
So we have another question right here, but I want to say, first of all, that looking at standards is something that can come out of the focus groups in the consortium. And if it's something that's really important to the community, you know, that should be toward the top of the list of the things that you want to work on in the focus group. So I hope you can talk about that as we go forward.
Great. Thank you. Thanks, Michael, for all your leadership on this. This is super exciting.
Thank you.
Kind of get goosebumps talking about this stuff when you talk about moving beyond Earth. So my name is Ed Herderick. I'm at Ohio State University. One thing that I would love for the consortium to have some element to is engaging students and sort of future workforce. I think these environments are really good for that, right? Because we can have industry and the government labs, of course, saying what they want from students in the future. But especially at the time scale we're talking about, I mean, even the first missions we're talking 2024. So I just kind of wanted to highlight that. And maybe one second thing I'll mention is, you know, I have a real passion for undergraduate engineering education. I think a lot of the work that we naturally gravitate to is, you know, the higher specificity, graduate level type science. I just love to figure out how we, you know, unpack that and do that in this consortium.
This is an area that personally I have a lot of interest in. And when I was running a Google Lunar X Prize team, made it like one of my most important jobs was to make sure that the students who were so passionate about getting into this field had opportunities to talk to the places where they could get those jobs and get out there at the undergraduate level. Some of them became master's candidates, many of them didn't, most of them didn't. And so thank you for that. And we have talked about can the consortium be a network by which universities can help the companies, large and small, understand where to find the workforce that they need, while also letting the students very rapidly see where the job opportunities are. And answering jobs online is a lot less effective than knowing and having the sort of advocacy that I'm sure you give to your students. So thank you. That's definitely going to be an important part of what we're doing.
Yeah, and I want to add to that, from day one, I agree with Michael, we have said that's going to be a huge focus. And that's one of the reasons that today we wanted to announce here the Lester opportunity that I talked about earlier. And so one of the things we added in there is that the students would come here to the biannual reviews and have the poster sessions and get that valuable face time with industry and other academia and nonprofits. And I think that's really important to not just have venues where there's other students in other universities, but kind of real world venues like this one where they get to interface.
Hi, Gordon Ressler from Robots in Space. This goes to the first question up there. How can this consortium work for your institution? Not just me, I'm a one-man show, but I consult to this organization called the U.S. Defense Department. And I don't see any blue suits in the room. And you might wonder, well, why would you? I mean, what do they have to do with going back to the moon? I think there are two reasons to do. But a more important reason comes from something that Deputy Administrator Morehard said at the Lunar ISRU workshop last summer. He's in the middle of his talk about how ISRU is important and that sort of thing. He said, and we know from history that when there are lines of communication, they must be defended. Now, the Space Force has heard that, but they have absolutely no idea what it means. So if you were to invite, you know, very small participation from the Defense Department, particularly the Space Force, you might be helping them. So that's how this consortium could work for that institution. Thanks.
Thank you. And Ben, or
I'd like to address the issue of picking winners and encouraging innovation. I was kind of sad to see that it looks like this your planning follows along with STMD. Okay, universities, you are off in the low tier or ghetto. If you want to do something at higher tier or else, well, that's company business or that's corporate. I was in a meeting very like this last week where NASA was for EVAs and NASA was saying, we'd love universities. We want you to propose. Here's our list of our critical technology gaps, propose against them. But you look at the list and it's like, we're doing this in-house and we're doing this in-house and we're doing this in-house. and this is SBIR, and this is in-house. And so there were like four gaps that weren't already set aside in-house at NASA or favorite contractors or SBIRs.
Okay, so if I might, the Luster program, which is still being developed right now, please understand that the purpose of that effort is to rapidly identify technologies that aren't like really low TRL, but things that have come far enough because of your efforts at your university that with the right application of funds could rapidly be deployed. It's the opposite of what you've just said.
Well,
earlier in the day when I was talking, the point I said, let's pause on that one bullet that said potential infusion. The idea there and the reason we're making those 2 years, which is relatively short for one of these, is exactly that. We're trying and we're going up to, I think for those we said TRL 2 to 5, but the main thing is that they have an infusion ramp into real work, even potentially leading to a flight demo. And that's the whole intent of that opportunity that we announced here today.
And I would say that the Niki mentioned the LSII systems integrator role that APL is playing as a part of this. I've worked at universities and I understand that at some point the research that happens at universities needs to take a step off in most cases, not in all cases, but in most cases, to go from the research lab at a university and into the, we're building something that's robust enough to put on a launch vehicle and send into space. And that's a leap that not all universities need to invest in order to bring value to the community. And so if we and STMD can take and identify those technologies that are right there ready to take that next step and enable that researcher to get their stuff out and into space quickly, that's the whole purpose. This is what we're trying to work towards, to address exactly the concern that you raised.
The other thing I'll add is just because we have an activity going on in a small business or in how in within the government or something, doesn't mean that we think it's precluded from a university or anyone else to do it. In fact, we look for that's the whole way we mitigate risk as our mission director, is to look for multiple ways of doing the same, solving a problem and investing in multiple ways. So we're not trying to hold that back at all just because we said we'll have something in mind.
Hi, I'm Tim Glotch, Stony Brook University. I'm also the PI for the RISE 2 survey team. So I want to speak in that capacity. One thing that I've really bought into in terms of survey is the mantra of science enables exploration and exploration enables science. We're jointly funded by HEO and SMD. But I think we also have a lot to offer to LSIC and STMD. We have teams like my own and Jen Hellman's right here that are experts in ConOps and field work and analog environments. So if you have a company that wants to test a technology in a lunar analog field environment, come talk to us. Tom Orlando and other team and his team and other teams are experts in modeling the lunar space environment interface. If that is helpful for you or your technology or what you want to do on the lunar surface, talk to us. I think our teams have already done a really good job of gathering and corralling a lot of expertise on really specific topics related to the space environment, to exploration, to dust mitigation, and lots of other things. And so I think half the PIs or so are here. So one thing I'd really like to see is interaction of survey with these different industry groups, university groups, because we're already funded to do this work, to do a lot of this work. I think we could present a lot of added value to LSIC and the STMD.
Yes, please, Rachel.
Now it is. All right. I think that's something that through some of the discussions between when I spoke and now also that I've had offline with people, I think it's really critical that, the LSIC focus is on these focus areas and on STMD's needs, but we're also providing these links out. And so I think that when we set up the website, one of the things we'll do is to make sure that people see that pathway of all the work that's going on at CERVI and that that's all visible because, we want to keep focus and not grow to be a giant beast that's competing with all of these other endeavors that are going on. But we want to connect people with them. And a lot of the community that's being built here too, There may be things, partnerships that you develop that are completely outside of the scope of this, but that's what we want to. We want to grow and nurture the community on the whole. So.
And I just want to reiterate that. It goes back to what Jake Bleacher was saying earlier. This is not at all meant to be duplicative. I know sometimes when we say the same thing that other people are saying, especially if you've worked at NASA for a long time, you think, oh, that's another one of those groups. We're saying the same thing because we're on the same page and we want to do the same work. So the big thing we want to do is create really the venue and the mechanism to get that done. So that was perfectly said. Thank you.
And before we get the next question, we had a telecon with the different groups at NASA centers that have worked on regolith simulants in the past. And towards the end of the telecon, they threw the question at us, the people at APL, what are you going to be doing to develop simulants? And I realized that for the previous many minutes of the conversation, they had missed one of the key points, is that we're not developing simulants. We know that others are doing that. And that our task that Niki had set us to was to try to understand what the characteristics were of available regolith simulants and what uses they could be put to for ISRU testing now, and what their availability was from a supply chain perspective. And so we are working really hard to make sure that this is not duplicative. And so where questions like that one that we got on the telecon last week come up, please know that all of the work that we're doing is really focused on what LSII is asking us to dig into and to bring all of us together to help them answer these questions that the agency has said, this is a thread of technologies that they believe need to be advanced more rapidly than they have been in order to achieve this sustained reality beyond Artemis as we move forward. So
two, I'm Betsy Cantwell from the University of Arizona. Two points about universities that I think are more universally true, and I really want to make sure we stay focused on the right language. Typically, our experience, probably for most of you in the room, is that universities are not low TRL deserts, and in large part these days have moved from a 1990s sort of modality to being measured on impact. And impact is not merely tech transferring something that's been turned into IP. It is literally working on programs all the way up through TRL 6 or even 10. And the reason I bring that up is because as we think about partnerships for something like this, it will be case by case with each university as to what they are capable of and what they want to do. And if we lock them into a verbal box about they only do basic research, you are really missing the boat. Second thing, completely different, but universities, for the most part, don't have business development budgets or offices. We have research development in the sense that we support our faculty in what they want to do. So when we think about something like participate, you know, quarterly focus groups, really adding FTEs into an effort like this over time, the earliest stage thing you can do is find ways to drip some support for students. It's the cheapest way to do this. It's the way that each senior administrator or president at a university sees that this is of value. It's not really going to pay for participation in focus groups, but it's incredibly important that the earlier you can make that happen, the more we will be able to demonstrate internally that this is a valuable thing for us to be engaged in. Thanks.
Thank you. David here? Oh, I'm sorry, Ben. Sorry, at the last meeting that I ran, Ben was actually one of my microphone runners. And so I thought he was running the microphone, but he actually has a question this time.
Ben Alterman, Southwest Research. I want to thank everybody who's brought up students because I think that they're incredibly important. And I want to ask, we talked about like having students come here, for example, and just present their work and meet people. But if we're talking about creating a lunar economy, we're not talking one, two, three missions. We're talking things that will have impact across several generations. So I want to ask, what are we going to do that's not just going to like say, hey, here's some money for students. How can we bring students into this? And how can we put them into these groups that we're talking about? How can we talk about bringing them into maybe leadership development for these groups so that's not just us running it, but we're also transferring the things we learn as we learn them to students so that impact permeates out to them? And what can we do to really fuse that into how we're thinking about this?
You know, I've said that we are aligning our focus groups with LSII's focus areas. And it occurs to me that perhaps one way to achieve what you were talking about is that one of our quarterly meetings could perhaps be specifically for students, for their advisors, and to build a forum where that discussion happens almost right off the bat.
So I'm going to share a little bit of my past, just because I think you'll see my mind. I don't in any way draw lines between students actually being part of flight projects. The first 8 years of my career was through my entire bachelor's program and master's program. I worked at a university that was part of the commercial space centers way back in the day. We've got a couple of those folks here where we flew 10 shuttle missions a year working with companies and universities, and it was tech demo hardware. I was literally 18 years old up until my 20-ish something, and it was never a question. No one even knew I was a student half the time at KSC or Johnson, and I thought twice about it. So in my mind, I just don't draw those lines. What I try to do is create the mechanisms we need to get them in the room doing the work. I don't care if you're a student or a retiree that's coming back or anything in between. So that's why we want to have opportunities like Lester that lead to real infusion and real flight projects. And I'm confident we'll have a lot of students involved in that.
And I appreciate that. And I guess part of what I'm asking is I want to actively have that conversation with you and have that as a group, because sure. I think that'll make it so it's more than just you thinking about it and how to do it, but other people will start seeing that you absolutely have value in it. And because your value is invested in it, then we will start to do that more.
And that's why that's one of the tenets on one of our charts. We show it, but the workforce thing, that's why we very consciously and deliberately from day one, don't just say it, but we have it on the chart that that's one of the key tenets of what we're trying to do. So I agree completely, but please keep bringing that point up over and over and hold us accountable to it.
Before you go on, is this a follow-on? Because we have a new question from a new voice that I don't think we've heard yet. So go ahead with the follow-on.
Real quick. So just to follow on this, I think the real important point is to keep bringing it up, and then for us to be creative about ways to find to get people in. For instance, we have a workshop coming up at the end of April called the Lunar Science Surface Science Workshop, and that'll be online as well. So you can dial in and listen as needed. But one of the creative ways, and this actually came from the Gateway workshop almost 2 years ago now, the meeting is intended to be like meetings like you're discussing here, collaborative and creating discussion. And so we actually have early career folks serving as scribes in those meeting rooms. And then they actually present back to the entire group, because we have these panels at the same time. And so it really puts them in a driver's seat, because they're the ones who then communicate it back to the entire group. And so that... just trying to think of those creative ways to get folks in, because then they create those relationships that they carry forward, and they, sometimes they help write reports, things like that.
So I would like to introduce our early career scribe, James. Could you stand up and wave? This is James Mastandria. He's been basically taking notes nonstop since we started this morning. And thank you, James. Yeah, that's right. Yes.
Hi, my name is Elizabeth Frank, and I'm an applied planetary scientist at First Mode. Before that, I was at Planetary Resources, the asteroid mining company. So I come from an academic background, and I've been in the commercial space sector for the past 4 years. And I think that one of the biggest impediments that we're going to see is the interaction of the planetary science community with industry. It took me about a year working at Planetary Resources to understand really how a company works, what the motivations are. And so I'm realizing the cultural differences, the jargon differences, the motivations that are different between these two communities. And over the past 2 years, I've been speaking up to the planetary science community about, looking for job opportunities for students outside of academia, because it's something I'm very passionate about and something that's worked really well for me. But at the same time, I think that there are going to be challenges on behalf of the industry partners if they don't have planetary scientists on staff and they are developing hardware that's going to interact directly with the lunar surface or go into orbit around the moon. So as a solution, I'd like to suggest some kind of co-op or internship program for planetary science grad students, postdocs, early career researchers. We're interested in kind of bridging that gap between academia and industry. And I think that would be a way to kind of facilitate communication and collaboration between these very different groups of people, but also provide new career pathways for planetary scientists.
Thank you. That's right in the wheelhouse of our ideas about the consortium being an opportunity for mentoring, not just of new companies and new entrants into the industry, but new people. So thank you.
So I had a suggestion, maybe it's a question, but it's more of a suggestion and a shout out. Our friend from Bechtel was the only one that I saw of all of the presenters that had a Twitter handle. One of the things, and now I'll say one more thing that seems disconnected, but trust me, it is. I've never met Lindy Elkin-Stanton, but some time ago, she accepted my friend request on Facebook. So I feel like I know her because she posts a lot. And I know a lot about the Psyche mission because she posts a lot. So those two are connected in that, you know, I haven't heard you guys talk much about using a social media platform in order to enable this kind of collaboration, you know, workshops and meetings and grants and all that kind of stuff that both costs money to support and attend and prepare for. Those are slow and, dare I say, middle-aged ways of communicating. So I guess my suggestion is, let's figure out a way to use Twitter or Facebook or Instagram. I mean, there's not many pictures anybody wants to share, maybe, but let's figure out a way to, you know, step up the pace of communication to where we are now.
You're reminding me of my 16-year-old son who almost never ever answers the phone when I call him, but communicates a lot with me regardless. And thank you for that. And in fact, we have to this point, because this has been moving as rapidly as it has, we have set up the webpage for people to register and the front page to see what the ideas that are beginning to drive the consortium are. But we absolutely have plans for the webpage becoming a website and for a social media presence that speaks to the way that we communicate today. Absolutely. That is definitely going to be a part of this. We haven't had the horsepower over the last 6 months to put that in place yet, but that is definitely a part of the vision.
And to being streamed on Facebook and YouTube. The web streaming today.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, yes. And we're, yeah.
Facebook and YouTube, yeah. But we will be employing further.
The fellow back here, I bet he uses text and Twitter a lot more than it comes to conferences.
No, I'm actually the uncle.
Yeah. Very good. Have you been live? You've been live tweeting. Thank you. Excellent. And in fact, Tori Bruno's Twitter is actually quite dynamic and sometimes very amusing. Yeah. So.
I'm Deep Space Dave.
Ah! Wow. Hey, that's a good one. Excellent.
Okay. Returning back to the issue of standards, commonality. Back in the day, we had two top-level requirements in advanced automation with respect to automation and robotics for the space station. One, the space station was supposed to be robot-friendly, and secondly, it was supposed to have an evolvable level of automation autonomy. We were supposed to turn those into verifiable requirements that resulted in a system that could actually be assembled. Seated was one, we had real requirements. Okay. Yeah. There's nothing like the reality of having to have a.
Agreed.
We have to get out of the traditional standards process is arguably hopelessly hidebound in terms of any form of credible decision velocity. Okay. What we went off and did is we created a robotic systems integration standards that had one volume of accommodation requirements, which said everything we knew about what it was that we were trying to build, okay? Interface standards where everybody took, each of the key players took and provided example interfaces that they thought met the requirements.
So are you speaking idea of the consortium at this point or
yes.
Something bigger?
So we did this as the systems engineering and integration contractor, but what we ended up doing was we then took those interface design prototypes and we did a round robin. And had all the other folks test the other ones. And we discovered that everything that we thought we knew was wrong. Okay. And it was absolutely transformative in terms of being able to accelerate the ability to come forward with credible and interoperable standards.
Okay.
So what we've got to do is a combination of real requirements. It's a combination of understanding that we have to get the best information to the table possible in terms of what we know and what we know we don't know. And that is what can enable you to have credible integration standards for this in the time frame needed.
Thank you. And we're going to take one last question here before we break for 3 o'clock, which is the networking session. Before we take your question, we are during this during this networks, oh, along the back. So all of the different focused areas, LSII and the consortium, APL is going to have people on our staff buy those to facilitate some of the networking that we want to go on over the next hour or so. There's still some more food and drinks for you to stay and to talk and to continue these conversations. As we said, there's going to be more email that will go out, more information on our website, and notices about the first of these quarterly meetings run by the focus groups. And we hope that you will go to, and is it your previous slide? I want to put that up now and leave this up while we're here. Please go to this survey and fill in the very small number of questions that we've gotten, and so that we can understand where your lies within all of this, whether it's standards or regolith or dust mitigation. What is it that you're most interested in? Are you interested in volunteering at some point to be on the executive committee? Are you interested in hosting a future workshop? Tell us what you would like to do to help move this forward. So with that, let's take this one last question, and then we'll break for our networking session. And actually, before you go, did you want to say something at the end as well?
Hello. I just wanted to first thank everybody again for coming, and I wanted to take a minute to give a round of applause to APL. He is not kidding when he said that we really moved out on this. Hold on one second, on the round. We'll do it all together. We really moved out on this, and they have just done a phenomenal job pulling this together. And we did want to kind of, it's not fully up and running, but that was somewhat intentional because we wanted to have it at this point to get your feedback, to do these surveys, and to make sure we build a consortium that's useful for all of us. So thank you so much, APL. This has been a beautiful venue, and it is such a pleasure to be able to work together on this. We'll give a round of applause.
If you actually liked showing up this morning and having a badge and having coffee and being able to get lunch and everything, I'd like to recognize all of our event staff,
yes,
all of the folks that you saw running
Shannon,
everywhere, doing
Lisa,
everything. Shannon, Lisa, thank you very much, guys.
Brian and Linda, thank you. You all did a great job. Thank you for pulling all this together.
I hope you hear my virtual clap. I would have clapped, but I'm holding a microphone. I was a student on the 2006 Bechtel study. So the guy that was standing behind me, Paul, was another grad student, Colorado School of Mines, supporting Bechtel in that lunar base study. And we looked at some commercial stuff at that time, feasibility conditions and things like that. I think we're doing a great job of educating students. This is a very inspiring topic. I think we're actually doing a great job of promotion. I got a three-part question.
Okay.
The first part is, how many people in the audience are business people that actually have to make, you know, profit and loss decisions? Got quite a few of that. All right. How many people in this room are Wall Street investment bankers? I don't see any. All right.
Just kidding.
Oh,
no.
Good. Yay.
Just kidding. I didn't tell you about my other job, Mike. No. Sorry.
I thought there was going to be one here. Actually, he texted me earlier. He didn't make it. There's a very simple point here. When this room has got more investors or investment bankers than engineers or scientists, I'll know that we're making actual progress because we've actually identified a market and some customers that we can address. My question is, and this is not rhetorical at all, what can this community do and what can NASA do to help create a marketplace? I've heard ULA use the words cislunar marketplace quite a bit. What can be done to actually create a viable marketplace to seed these companies and get it? My framework is, you know, I watched Deep Space Industries fail because they didn't know who their customer was. They didn't have one. I watched Planetary Resources fail because they didn't have a customer. If we don't have customers in space, all of these ideas of like commercial things are going to fail. So what can be done about that?
So that's a really big question for the last question of the day. I'd like to propose that those of you who have interest in discussing exactly that question right now, you are the central focus group, where the others are spread out on the side. I was at a meeting last week with Niki and some others where there were some folks from the investment side, from the mining community, where they talked about the amount of money that goes in to doing exploratory prospecting and how often it fails and so forth. And this was a really interesting part of that discussion. I mean, it was because they were kind of like, oh, well, wow, this has got quite a horizon on it. There was an eye opener for them. But I really believe that the future here is built upon the fact that the U.S. government has for decades and for generations bought down the risk of the hardest things early and done what it needs to do in order to create those things in the future. And even though we might not have the answer in the room right now to that question, this is the habit that the country has been in since its founding. And so with that, I would like to...
And I'll just add...
Oh, yeah. So please, Jim.
If it's
yeah.
all right.
Yeah.
You know, the things that we've tried to do with the International Space Station is create a commercial cargo activity, create a, you know, we're a primary user. We're not the, try to, and so with that came quite a bit of capability on cargo and now commercial crew. Now when you, and so our interest is certainly expanding that LEO commercial market at the same time as we go farther. And with it though, it's not just NASA. When you look at the construction and the operations that were going on developing the part that's our vision of how far we would go as NASA, it's almost all commercial launches. We have a CLPS program, a commercial lander services that we have now 14 IDIQs for something that would be potentially and we can be a user of those landers. So we can be that core, but what we're looking for is to be the minority and help expand the commercial needs. So we're trying to create those opportunities there. And so we're looking then, you know, we'll establish some activities on the moon, but we're not necessarily going to be the one that makes that into a large platform. At that point, we're looking for it to be commercial and other entities. The human lander system also is another example of where we're looking for more and more is how we buy service.
Thank you, Jim. And with that, we'll adjourn for now for the networking hour and adjourn finally at 4:00 today. Thank you all very much. Oh, that's weird.